Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
Finally, some good stats to talk about for the Flames. After this past week of games, we're now 7-1 in the overtime when we're playing 3-on-3, 1-1 in the shootout. We have 9 wins in a row under the Saddle Dome, and we had a perfect homestand this week. Finally, things are looking up for this team. And as usual, I'm Dan alongside Matt. Matt, how do you feel right now?
Eh, I'm okay. You know, not much you can ask on a 5-game homestand than collecting 5 victories.
Then a perfect week. The week we need to be perfect, we were perfect.
Yeah, and now Calgary is back within striking distance of the playoff teams, and the bizarre season that we've been having continues.
Yeah, the Flames now sit, as we record this, on December 14th. The Flames are sitting at 28 points. The third-place team in the West, the team that we have to beat to get a playoff spot, is San Jose Sharks, who have 30 points, and we have 2 games in hand on them. So if we keep playing like this, those 2 games are going to end up with 4 points, I think. Well, Matt, let's break down the week, shall we?
Sounds like a good idea.
We came off the 2-game win streak last week. We were quite excited. We beat Dallas, beat Boston. We weren't sure if we could transition those wins into another week of wins here at the Dome. But last Tuesday on the 8th, the Flames played against the San Jose Sharks, a game that you and I both thought we may or may not win. I thought we probably would. You weren't quite sure. But the Flames ended up winning that game 4-2 against the San Jose Sharks. And to me, I thought this was just another game like the week before, where the Flames just did everything right and, you know, ground down the other team and finally got the win. What was your take on this one?
And well, it was a marked improvement from the last time we faced them back in the Shark Tank. The Flames were playing more their style of puck possession game that they finally started to play once the homestand began. And they just controlled the play. And when Calgary plays that way, they're a top team. And we haven't seen that for the first 2 months. But now, as the December began, now we're beginning to see them play more their style of game and control the play instead of reacting to the opposition.
Yeah, I think the Flames came out in this one. I mean, Granlund got an early goal, and I think the Flames really dictated the pace. They made the Sharks, I feel, almost play more the game the Flames wanted to play instead of waiting for the Sharks to set the tempo, which I thought was probably a huge piece to this. And getting that early goal, now, unfortunately, Ramo let in an early goal again, which is another story for later in the show, but they were able to rebound quite well from that. And you know, we saw all the guys that we needed to see, including Michael Backlund, who got his 4th of the year, really playing a top game again. So that gave me hope for the rest of the week.
Yes, and one of the main problems that the Flames had in the early part of the season was a lack of scoring depth. And it was basically the Gaudreau show, and if he wasn't on, then
no
the Flames
scoring.
Were going to lose.
Yeah.
So, like, in that San Jose game, we did get a goal from Monahan, but the other goals were Granlund, Frolik, and Backlund. And we started to see defensemen getting more points. The Flames had 7 assists in that game from their defensemen, which is actually the most of any team's defense core around the league in any game this season. So we're starting to see parts of what made the Flames successful last year.
If we break down the goals on that one, we had a Marcus Granlund goal, his 2nd of the year, assisted by Yari Hudler and Dennis Weidman. So there's a defenseman, as Matt was saying, Weidman's 12th assist. We had a power play goal from Sean Monahan, assisted by Giordano, his 4th assist, and Weidman, his 13th. So there's 2 defensemen. And then we had a Frolik goal assisted by Backlund and Dougie Hamilton. And we had Backlund's 4th goal of the year assisted by Giordano and Brody. So Gio picked up a ton of points in that game too. And, you know, you were talking about getting back into last year's form. I don't know about you, but I think we're finally starting to see Giordano, I mean, even looking at the stats here, we're starting to see Giordano coming back into the form he was last year. I wouldn't say he's quite to that Norris level yet, but I think we're starting to see him ramping up his game from what we saw in the first 2 months.
Oh, for sure. Like, he now has 6 goals and 6 assists on the season, which is a lot less than he had last year, but it's starting to pick up. Like, he has 4 points in his last 4 games. It's coming along. And anytime you're dealing with an injury like he suffered, you're not going to magically get better instantaneously. Any type of, like, wrist or, you know, tearing your bicep apart or any of the other difficult injuries for shooting the puck or passing, it takes a while to recover. And now he's finally seeming, after, I think, what, 10 months, to be coming into his own once again.
Yeah, it's really nice to see. I mean, he's the guy, he's the captain, I think, that we're looking at as one of our premier defensemen, and he's starting to look on the ice like he's one of our premier defensemen. Well, Matt, we took that win against the Sharks, and we were able to get another one. The Flames were able to take the Buffalo Sabres in the Dome again, and they got a 4-3 win over the Sabres in regulation. This was an interesting game. This was a game that saw a lot of lineup changes that were unexpected. As usual, Ramo was expected to start this game, but Ramo was actually got sick just moments before the game. Hiller was his backup, and Hiller had been sick. He hadn't practiced for 2 days before. He left practice the day before because of sickness, but I guess Ramo started throwing up in the dressing room, and they had no choice but to throw Hiller in. So I was nervous. I don't know about you going in hearing that both of our goalies were so sick, and Hiller's happened to be the least sick of the two.
Yes, and it actually does make sense in a way to have Hiller start in a situation where both guys are sick due to the fact that Hiller does not move around as much in his net. He's more positional style of goaltender, where Rommel's more of an athletic guy, and if, you know, both guys are throwing up, you want to have the guy that's moving around the least going instead of somebody that's up and down and all around.
Yeah, for sure.
Because, but you know, I mean, more apt to actually, you know, get sick on the ice.
I mean, it's been a long time since Hiller's played, and I wasn't sure what to make of the fact that he's probably rusty, plus he's sick. Like, it seemed like we were doomed. And then not only that, Yari Hudler was out again with the flu, so Michael Ferland, who hasn't played played much, drew back in the lineup in his place. So lots of guys sick, and actually I heard that the next day, the 3 sick guys weren't even allowed back into the rink. Like, the Flames wanted to almost quarantine them.
Yeah, which makes sense. It's just one of those fun situations, and a lot of teams are having difficulties with illness.
I wonder if we can, like, weaponize this, and when we go on the road, we could take, you know, Yari Hudler and have him go cough in the other dressing room or something.
Yeah. Just get him to skate by the bench, just coughing randomly.
There you go. Or get him to fill their water bottles and lick him on his way.
That's just nasty.
Isn't it? This was a game that I had fun watching. I don't know about you. It wasn't a great hockey game. It seemed like it was, especially the first period, pretty boring. But just to watch what the Flames were doing, it was an interesting game to watch. I mean, the Flames got up to a 2-goal lead. Buffalo came back and tied it up. Flames got up to a 3-2 lead. Buffalo tied it up. And then just in the dying minutes of the period, we got the big Johnny Gaudreau goal. And I was convinced there at the end that Buffalo was going to score again and we'd have to take this to extra time.
Yeah, Buffalo's really a terrible hockey team. And like we saw in the first 2 periods, the Flames managed to limit their offensive chances, and like Hiller wasn't really even tested much at all. So, which that in and of itself was a good thing to see, progress in the defensive end of the game. But,
well, if you look, we had 3 goals on 30 shots on a sick goaltender who's hardly played. 2 of those goals were on the power play, and 1 was really awful. So really, I mean, you know, the goals, you can't really look at it and fault Hiller much for what happened in that game.
No, like the first two goals by Ruustalainen, he could have possibly had it. You know, especially the second one.
Yeah.
That one just, you don't usually see guys firing pucks from the point without a screen that just beat the goalie clean. The third one, it banked in off of a player, so that happens. On the whole, I think if Hiller was 100% healthy, I don't think Buffalo scores a goal in that game. But they were able to keep it out and keep it up and got the 2 points. Also, interesting thing to note, with Ruustalainen getting a hat trick, he became the youngest defenseman in NHL history to actually record a hat trick.
Wow. That was his fifth, sixth, and seventh goals this year.
Yeah. Calgary is always willing to offer up milestones, so why not have an NHL record being set against us?
There you go. And, you know, it doesn't feel so bad when at least we win the game and that record's been set against us.
True.
To give some credit to the Sabres, I thought that their young stars all had good games. I mean, Ristolainen had a great game. I thought Reinhardt looked good out there. Vander Kane had a good game. It was really, you can tell that there's some promise for this organization going forward.
Yes, they, like the Oilers, though, they're a little top-heavy, and they don't have a lot of depth still, so that's why, they like, for the first 40 minutes, the Flames were basically containing them in their zone. So, we'll have to see, like, if Buffalo can figure out a way to add to their depth as well.
We got some goalies and defensemen they can have.
True. I think they're good in both categories, though, unfortunately.
Maybe them and Edmonton need to make some trades. Edmonton's top-heavy, and Buffalo might be back-heavy.
Yeah. We'll see.
When I look back at the Buffalo game and I kind of try to sum it up, it seems like the Flames made it really harder on themselves than they needed to. It should not have taken 4 goals to put that team away.
No.
And the you know, not only 4 goals, but, like, you know, there were some goals in there that, I don't know, the Flames had to play really hard to earn. And it just seemed like the whole night they were making it a lot harder on themselves than they needed to, which, you know, the Flames are known, their attitude is a team that plays hard, a team that fights till the end, and okay, so this is our identity. But, I don't know, it seemed like the effort didn't really pay off in the end. I guess we got the 2 points and it did, but it seemed like it should have been easier.
Well, it seems like this team is having, like, the polar opposite start that they had last year. Like, the first 2 months, the Flames were good last year, terrible this year. Had that long losing streak in December. Now we have a long winning streak. In the third periods, the Flames always came back last year. Now we're getting leads in the first 2 periods and blowing them every time.
I didn't think about that. You're right.
It's bizarro world, but, you know, it seems to be working out. It's just weird how a team that's made only a couple of minor alterations can be doing, like, the exact opposite.
For sure. The line that I was most excited about in this game, I don't know about you, was the Granlund-Colborne line. They look good all night. I thought that Joe Colborne played his best game of the year. We really haven't seen a lot from Colborne this year. I haven't been all that excited about him, but I think we may have finally found the line mate for Granlund, who got his second goal in 2 nights, getting his third of the year, assisted by Hamilton and Colborne. What did you think of Colborne in this game?
I thought Colborne had a really great game. Unfortunately, it lasted only the one game, because the next night against the Rangers, he ended up getting relegated to the fourth line.
Yeah, but I don't think necessarily that means that he's, you know, I don't want to say it's hot streak, but I think he could come back and be put back on that third line or higher. I mean, he did get a goal in the Rangers game, so even though he's on the fourth line, he was still playing hard.
Yeah, for sure. It's just, with him, he's been very inconsistent all year, almost to the point of somewhat being disappointing at times, and it's good to see him have a couple of good games. I think that he, along with guys like Mason Raymond and Josh Juris, are kind of on the bubble fighting for that those last roster spots.
Yeah, and I mean, we know that that Colborne was brought in to be a depth guy, and he's definitely a depth guy, but yeah, I don't see the Colborne that we saw last year, and who knows what it's going to take to spark that, but if we don't see that from him again, I'm not convinced that Colborne's going to be a long-time Flame. I think that right now, at least, he's looking like he could be an expendable piece.
And it's one of those situations that, like, if a trade comes around and he's a piece that might be an asset in that, might help to make the deal work. It's frustrating because, like, you see the potential in him. And anytime you have a 6'5" center that's big, can play on the wing, you wish that he could have that intensity and bring it consistently to generate offense. It's just when he blips in for a couple of games and then vanishes for like a month. There are better players out there long term than having somebody that inconsistent.
But if you take a look, too, at his stats the past couple of years here as a Flame, in 2013-2014 with the Flames, he played 80 games and got 28 points. This year, 2013-2014, 80 games, 28 points. 2014-2015, he played 64 games and got the same 28 points. And so far, he's played 24 games and has 11 points. So even though he's looking inconsistent, he's on par to do better numbers this year than he has the last couple.
Yes. Yeah, he is. It's just, you like to see more. Because you can see when he's on his game that he could be an impact forward. It's just...
But I think that inconsistency is a big reason why he's, you know, a fourth line and third line guy.
True.
And a guy that we gave up a fourth round pick to get. I mean, if you're one of the, you know, most consistent guys, you're going to be playing a lot more ice time than Colborne is.
True enough.
So, you know, I think for what his role is, you're right, he's got potential, but I think he's 25. I think at this point we know what Joel Colborne is as a player. I think we know what we're getting and what he can and can't do. And I think for his role, he fits it well. And I think when Bouma comes back, which we'll talk about later, we might see a little bit more out of Colborne, because I wouldn't be surprised if those two are put together. Finishing the wrap-up of the week, the last game we played was the one I was the most nervous about this week. We played the big, mighty New York Rangers here at the Dome, and the Flames ended up winning that one in overtime, 5-4. Matt, going into this one, did you think that the home winning streak was going to come to an end?
They were the team I was most concerned about, and with reason. The Flames have struggled mightily against the New York Rangers. One positive coming into the game is that they were absolutely terrible in the last 9 games prior to playing the Flames, with only 2 wins in those 9 games. So that made me a little bit more hopeful when we actually got to game day. And we saw the Flames get out to a 4-1 lead against them before, you know, assorted goaltending problems.
Yeah, well, I mean, a 4-1 lead, the Rangers scored early, the Flames had a goal from Goudreau, a goal from Raymond, a goal from Goudreau again, and then a Colborne goal. And yeah, it was 4-1, and I mean, right there, if you can get yourselves up 4-1 against the Rangers, you should have that game in
especially
hand.
Especially with only 15 minutes remaining. Like, it's not like they had to kill off the last half of the game. It was just 15
no,
minutes.
No, or you get up 4 goals in the first period and you got 40 minutes to play. That should have been enough. I mean, Colborne's goal, the one to put us up 4-1, came at 4:57 in the third. So, yeah, you got about 15 minutes and you should be able to kind of buckle down, play some defensive hockey, and get out of there.
Unfortunately, though, that goal that Hiller surrendered on the next shift to Tanner Glass was one of the worst goals that the Flames have surrendered this season. And that, as soon as that puck went in, when I was at the game, I even said, oh, the Rangers are going to come back probably because of how bad of a goal that was. Yeah. And sure enough, they scored another one where the defense was standing around, and then the late power play goal.
By Zuccarello. Yeah. And after those three, I mean, it seemed like in the last 15 minutes there, the Rangers took control. And I was pretty sure that we, you know, I thought we're lucky to get to overtime. There's no way we're getting out of this with 2 points.
Well, once the puck dropped in overtime, because of Calgary's track record of being awesome 3-on-3, I was assuming that the Flames would score eventually, and TJ Brody fired it in for the winner.
Yeah. You know, I think for me, the best way to look at this is the Flames gave up a game they shouldn't have given up. I mean, when you got a 4-1 win, as we said, with 15 minutes left, it should be your game. And they've got to be breathing a sigh of relief because they managed to win it in the end. And really, in the record books and the score sheets, no one's going to remember the, you know, 2 months from now, no one's going to remember the 4-1 victory. They're just going to remember the 4-1 score, and then the fact we won 5-4, it's going to be 2 points. And I think the Flames really have to be sighing a sigh of relief that they were able to keep this one in their favor. So I really think that the Flames are lucky to get out of this one with 2 points, especially when you let the Rangers come back and tie a game with that little time left. What do you think, Matt?
Getting the 2 points is the most important thing, and it gives the Flames coaching staff the ability to have something to harp on. If the Flames wrote it out 4-1 and limited the Rangers to like nothing for the rest of the game, there's not a lot that the coaching staff can use as evidence, like, you need to work on this, you need to work on that. With them not being able to hold the lead once again, they can use that as motivational tools to get them to work on the details throughout the 60 minutes. And even though they've won 5 in a row, they can still use this as a tool to get them to work out their bad habits.
A teaching tool.
Exactly. And with that, like, a lot of times teams that go on winning streaks, they start getting bad habits creeping into their game towards the end of the winning streak. But
you get cocky.
Exactly. Can't do any wrong, and we're just awesome, and we're just going to beat everybody. But with how the Flames have struggled with maintaining leads all through this homestand and the winning streak, it still gives the coaching staff tools to say, well, yes, you're getting the results, but you're not doing it in the best way, and if we don't correct these things, that winning streak will just be a blip in the radar.
Yeah, it's a good point. I didn't think of it that way, but no, you're right. I think it's definitely, I think it also sort of makes them really reflect on how much they had to do to win that game. You know, the night before when I think they put, or the game before when they put in too much effort to beat Buffalo, I think that this one was really, look, guys, if you work hard, you can do this. Like you said, it gives the coaching staff something to show them, and it does. It points out some holes that the Flames have in their game. It was not a perfect game by any stretch of the imagination.
No, and realistically, out of the entire 5-game homestand, the only really consistently good effort was the San Jose game.
Yeah.
And even then, they blew the lead twice. So it's one of those things that, like, okay, great, you're getting out to the lead. Now, the next step is, how do you keep it? I think the Flames have only won, like, 4 or 5 games where they haven't surrendered the lead this season. So that's not exactly an encouraging thing.
No, it's not.
Even though the Flames are within a couple of points of a playoff spot, they only have 5 regulation wins, and they've only won 3 games on the road. And unfortunately for the Flames, the next 4 games are all on the road against the elite teams in the NHL.
Well, I think you point out something important there that, you know, it's easy to overlook now because we're all in this sort of euphoria of a five-game home winning streak, but the Flames still have a lot of problems. You know, this is not a team that went from being last place in the NHL to now staring at a playoff spot and all of a sudden they're perfect. I mean, you know, any team that's not top in their conference has problems. That's why they're not number one generally. And yeah, this team still has a lot to work on. And really, this is a building block. This is confidence for these guys. It's okay, look, guys, you can win games. We just did it. Keep going. But we need to build on these things in order to get more of them.
And that's one of the things that the Flames will have to look forward to as the season continues to progress, on getting those consistent good habits going. So even if you're having an off night, you can still do the little things correctly. And that's something that has been lacking for most of the year.
Yeah, I think the biggest thing for me right now is how the Flames move through the rest of this month. And if we see the same type of effort, if we're seeing these wins where they're getting lucky again, these wins where they're, you know, giving up big leads, or if we're not, and if they can learn from a lot of the stuff. So to me, that's going to be the most interesting thing for the rest of December.
Yeah, especially playing three games against divisional opponents and a whole lack of games against elite teams. If you're not playing to their level, you're going to lose. And it's those little attention to details that will either make or break the season, really.
I agree with you, Matt. It's the attention to detail, and we're going to have to look into that and see how the Flames go forward and address some of that. So I'll be watching for some of that detail as we go forward. But you were mentioning earlier that we had some interesting sort of reversal of last year, right? That we started strong last year, now we've started poorly. We had the long losing streak, now the long winning streak. But you did also find in your research this week some similarities from this year to last year, which, I don't know, I found a little bit comforting as a Flames fan that for the rocky year we've had, it doesn't look in the end, stats-wise, all that different from last year. Do you want to share your research findings?
Yeah, the Flames have 8 less points at December 13th, which was the Rangers game. And that is obviously a lot worse, having 4 fewer wins. But relative to both the playoff team and the team with home ice, the Flames are actually in the same spot. They are trailing both teams by 2 points. Last year it was San Jose and Vancouver. This year it was Arizona and Vancouver. So it's interesting to see that even though this year has been pretty much a disaster up to this point, we're in the exact same spot. And if the Flames can continue to rebound and get their stuff together, which has been something that's lacking, the playoffs are still in reach. And the Flames did actually find a way to get to the postseason last year, even though they continued to lose after this point. So we'll see. It's just comforting that despite everything that's gone wrong, they're still technically in the same spot that they were last year.
Yeah, when you told me those stats, I thought that was really weird, because you look at the two seasons, if we look at them, you know, this point last year, if you were to go back and listen to our episode this time last year, we had a lot more to celebrate probably than we do this year. I mean, we had a good start. We had a lot of guys showing what they can do. This year, not so much. So it's interesting that we've got ourselves in the same place. Now, you could attribute that to a lot of factors, potentially the division we're in, a lot of things like that. But you know what? You got to take it how you get it. And I'm really surprised, honestly, that we're 2 points out from a playoff spot right now.
And home ice. Doesn't make any sense, but whatever, we'll take it.
Exactly. You can't always do things on your own. You've got to have the hockey gods help you once in a while. And it looks like that's what the Flames are doing this year. Let's talk a little bit about the team, some lineup changes, and some things that we're seeing brewing. There's some interesting, I think, stories to follow this week that maybe not everyone's looking at. And I think one of the big ones is Laddie Smead's return. We talked about him a couple weeks ago, how Laddie Smid had come back. He hadn't played a whole lot. The Flames sent him down to the AHL. He went down for, 1 game, and now he's back. And to me, Laddie Smead is not really looking like a guy who missed a year of hockey. Laddie Smead, to me, is looking like a, you know, 5-6 NHL defenseman. And he's been one of, I think, the best defensemen on the ice over this homestand.
I agree. And his improved play will do nothing but help the club out. And when you're having a team that's struggling defensively, having somebody that can come in and play a solid defensive defenseman role, that will help out the stability of the team overall.
Yeah, and you said the two key words, defensive defenseman. I talked to a lot of people about Laddie Smead, and I've been chatting about him on Twitter, and people keep saying, well, you know, Smead's not scoring goals, and Smead's not, you know, jumping into the rush as much, and not every defenseman you have can be, nor do you want every defenseman to be the big offensive defenseman. They're not all going to do the, you know, Brody-style point shots. And I think Smead is a great... You often pair those guys with a very defensive defenseman, and Laddie Smead has been that really good defensive defenseman. He's the guy who knows how to get the puck out of his end. He's the guy who knows how to kill time in his own end. And he's been one of the best at keeping the puck inside the other team's blue line when we're in the offensive zone. He's never going to be your big offensive defenseman. I mean, if you look at
Oh, no. I think he has, like, his career high in goals is 2 or 3 or something like that. So it's not... You're not going to expect him to put up 30 points
no.
or anything like that.
Yeah, with the Oilers, he got 5 points or 5 goals 1 year for 15 points. I think that's his career high. But he's a good, solid guy. And, you know, we could debate the contract on him, but I think that he's finally showing his worth and has been a very suitable replacement for Russell during Russell's injury.
Yeah. And I have a question for you. What do you think about his play along with Derek England? Does that make a guy like Kris Russell a little expendable?
Good question. You and I chatted about this a bit earlier. I think if we look at Russell, if we had Russell locked up long-term, I don't think so. But with a guy who's in the last year of his contract, who, as we've talked about before, probably isn't going to be back next year, Kris Russell, because of the big increase he wants, I think that Laddie Smead could be that guy who can fill in as Russell's hurt and if Russell gets moved. I think Smead's bringing out the best in England. I think England's playing some of the best hockey we've seen from him since he got paired with Smead. But yeah, I guess you could probably say that, yeah, I think Smead, I wouldn't say he makes Russell expendable, but I think he makes the decision potentially to move Kris Russell an easier one.
I agree with that. And I actually kind of like the defensive pairing of Hamilton with Weidman. And I don't think that that pairing with Russell subbed in for Weidman is as effective.
No.
And I think that the good third pairing of England and Smead does a good job of stopping the other team's third and fourth lines effectively.
Yeah, I mean, I think a Russell-Smead pairing would probably be better than an England-Smead pairing, but yeah, I definitely think if you're looking around the Flames roster saying, okay, if we move Russell, what do? We've got Smead locked up for this year and next year. We might as well take advantage of that. And yeah, I think it's going to make that decision easier for the Flames. Smead's a big guy. He's 6'4", 210. So he's a very tall defenseman, which is not, we don't have a lot of height on the back end. And I think that Smead's also trying to make up for lost time and probably trying to prove a little bit of worth there. So, you know what?
Well, you have to look at him looking around the league as well. Just like we mentioned with David Jones over the past couple of weeks. If he doesn't step up his game, he might not find another contract after next year.
Well, he's making 3.5 now, which if you look at the contracts we're going to have next year, I mean, you know, he's the only guy that's making less than him next year is Derek England. And at 3.5, he's getting pretty close to a guy like Brody, who's making just over $1 million more than him. So if we take the contract out of it, yeah, I think you're right. He's probably an NHL caliber defenseman the way he's playing, but he's definitely not worth what he's making. And I guess the question after this contract will be, is he willing to take probably a $2 million pay cut to stay in the league?
And is he able to find a similar contract that he's making now overseas? So it's one of those situations that it will he has to be motivated to play at his top level as well.
Yeah.
And we're seeing that. Like, he was the one that instigated getting sent down to Stockton in the first place.
Yeah, I guess that's kind of interesting. He actually asked Brad Treliving, the GM, to be sent down to the AHL for the conditioning stint. So I've never really heard of that before. Usually almost look at it as something the team is forcing on them. So it's good to hear that he's got that motivation to get back in shape and, you know, play the NHL game. But I don't know. I think Smead definitely gives us more options going forward. I wouldn't necessarily say that he's going to be the fill-in for Russell if Russell moves. You know, I'd like to see us bring up somebody like Nakladol and try him. But I think it definitely makes that decision easier. The other guy that I think is going to be interesting to watch in the lineup and what's going to happen there is Lance Bouma. Bouma's rejoining the Flames on this road trip, and it's expected he's going to play sometime on the road trip, I'd imagine. Matt, where do you think he's going to fit into the roster? Because right now we seem to have the roster clicking, and we've got four solid lines. Let's start with what line do you think he'll end up playing on and with who?
I think he'll slot in on the third line with Backlund and Frolik. I think the second line with Bennett, Granlund, and Hudler has played well. And I think you keep Jones with Gaudreau and Monahan. He hasn't hurt the team offensively in that spot, so I think you just run with him in that role for a while.
Yeah, and I...
Then it becomes a question of, Mason Raymond's playing well. Joe Colborne's playing well. Who do you get rid of out of the lineup in order to make room?
Well, that was the next thing I was going to ask you. So if you look at the roster, Marcus Granlund's the only guy that can be sent to the farm right now without clearing waivers. But every time you look at Granlund and think, maybe they'll send him to the farm, he scores a goal or he has a great game. So I would be very hesitant to send him down. In fact, I think it would be the wrong move. But Matt, if you had to waive somebody, which I think essentially, would you agree that you don't send Granlund down?
No, I think he's done enough, at least for the time being, that it would be a really bad move in terms of the always earned, never given mantra. He has 3 goals in 8 games. Like, if you translate that to an 82-game schedule, that's a 30-goal scorer.
You need to keep those guys in your roster.
Exactly. And with him being in the last year of waiver eligibility so he can just get sent down, you need to make sure that he can actually play in the NHL long term.
Well, and as we've talked about, there's nothing else for him to achieve at the AHL level, really. It's not like it's going to help his development. It would simply be a roster move.
Yes. And in terms of raw asset management, yes, Granlund is the move to make in that regard. But in terms of overall play and talent level, I think that the player that should get sent down is Josh Juris.
So you think they should waive Juris, expose him to the waiver process, and if he clears, send him down to Stockton?
Yes, and I think that with him only collecting 3 points in 20 games and not playing particularly well overall, he's doing all right on the penalty kill, but that's about it. Ideally, you'd send Brandon Bollig down, but the Flames still are needing that tough guy role. So you have to figure that they won't get rid of him. If it was me, I wouldn't keep Bollig around, but in terms of having that physical presence, they will keep him around. And I think Juris has lost his spot to Mason Raymond.
Can you believe we're saying that? Somebody lost their spot to Mason Raymond?
I know. Well, he has really improved his play of late, so I have to get...
True. I mean, he's definitely earned it, but just when you're thinking about these players and the way we've talked about them all year... I mean, we've ragged on Raymond for a good reason. He's looked terrible most of his run in a Flames jersey. And, you know, it's interesting. I wouldn't say he's anywhere near, you know, what we're paying him. He's not playing, you know, to a $3.15 million game. But he's looking like a good addition to this team finally.
Yeah, and if you're going with that always earned, never given, well, Raymond has earned the right to stay. And he has been impactful in games recently. Juris, when he's played, he's there, and you don't really notice him, and he doesn't really do anything. So, if you're just looking for who's standing out, you have to give the benefit of the doubt to Mason Raymond.
So I think if you look at Josh Juris, I think the Flames might be hesitant to put him on waivers after what happened to Paul Byron. I think Byron and Juris were kind of at a similar place in the depth chart, and after Byron got swiped, I think you might find someone who might swipe Juris too, so I'm not sure that they will send him down and expose him to waivers. I think the right move, if you're going to put someone on waivers, is Brandon Bolig. I mean, he's 28, he's making over $1 million, and really that fighter role is gone. I know what you're saying about the toughness, but I think that if you've got Bouma coming back in the lineup, and we've got Michael Ferland still in a Flames jersey playing at the NHL level, you can offset that toughness. But I think if I was the Flames, I'd be sending Brandon Bolig down. We also remember saw in the past that, you know, they have sent tough guys down. I mean, look at the McGrattan move when, you know, they sent McGrattan packing and he was the big tough guy. So I think you're going to see that they'll probably be gun shy to send Juris down. And I think Bolig's going to be the man that they move out.
And I would agree with that. It depends on which thing that the Flames place more emphasis on. That's all.
Yeah, I think it's one of those things, too, that if you look at what would I rather lose for nothing, if you assume, worst case, that you're going to lose the asset, Juris had a good year last year. Juris hasn't looked great this year, but he also hasn't, you know...
He's still dealing with the wrist problem that he had last year.
He's dealing with the wrist problem. He's probably having some sophomore slump. I think that he's owed a little bit more of a chance with the Flames once he's healthy. But I think that right now we owe Bolig nothing. And if I'm going to lose one of those guys for free, I'd rather have $1.25 million off the cap.
Can't argue with that.
And get rid of a 28-year-old fighter who really has probably got no place in the game anymore.
And I can't argue.
So I'm hoping it's going to be Bolig if they get rid of somebody. I think that Bouma can fill in some of that toughness.
And if you look at it, Bolig, even when he does play, he's not being overly physical. Like, even if you compare him to Michael Ferland, the last couple of games Ferland has been throwing those thunderous hits, and that's not really something that you're seeing from Bolig either. So between those two, even if you're looking for an impact, even Ferland is having more of an impact in that regard as well.
Well, I think if we look at Michael Ferland's short stint as a Flame last season, I mean, he really made his name as sort of that tough guy, that agitator, that sandpaper guy. The role that Lance Bouma was in a couple of years ago before his offensive production picked up, and I think you're going to see Bouma being that offensive guy that we saw last year. And, you know, Ferland hasn't played a whole lot, and I think if they move Boland out of here and give Ferland a better shot... It at least lets us see what we've got there, because his sample size is still very small. And I think even from a sort of marketing perspective, I see more Ferland jerseys than I do Bolig jerseys at the Dome. I think Ferland is that sort of fan favorite tough guy.
Well, he did pretty much help us win the first round of the playoffs last year, so that gives you a lot of leeway regardless.
No, for sure. But I mean, if you look last year, he only played 26 games last year. He's played 21 this year, so, you know, we haven't seen a lot of him in the regular season anyways as a Flame. He had 5 points in 26 games, got 3 points so far in 21 with the Flames, but I don't know, he's a young kid, he's 23. I think that there's still some benefit to Michael Ferland, but to get the benefit, we have to play him. And sitting him in the press box watching Bolig is not going to help.
No.
So I'm hoping the Flames move Bolig. I'm just, I don't know, I'm kind of gun-shy about putting Juris on waivers because I think that he might get Paul Byron. Do you think anyone would take Juris?
Probably.
And I'm not...
I could see probably 8 or 9 teams actually take him.
Yeah, and I'm not ready to give up on him yet. He's not having a great year, but maybe he needs another stint at the AHL level to, you know, rehab his wrist and get back into things. I also think that he could be a good line mate for some of our AHL guys, but I don't want to put him down there. Like, as much as I think he'd benefit from it, I don't know we can get him there.
No.
I'm not willing. If I was the GM, I wouldn't be willing to expose that risk. I'd rather keep him.
No, the only way that you would do that is if he continued to struggle all year and he struggled in training camp next year, then I think you could just waive him and get him to the farm. But
that's
a different situation entirely.
Exactly. And I think we've already kind of had our waiver fairy, if you will, and got Ordeo through.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to keep tempting it.
No.
You know, I mean, I would have been fine if we lost Raymond earlier this season for nothing. I would have been, you know, I'm fine if we lose Bolig for nothing. I think that if we run into injury troubles, Juris has proven in the past last year that he can help us. And I think it's just a matter of, you know, giving him another shot. So, yeah, I'm hoping Bolig's the guy that goes down. We don't need to be paying a fighter $1.25 million. And as you said, Bolig's trying to change his game. He's not trying to be that big physical guy. And I just don't think he's got it in him. Like, he doesn't look like a guy who can be your sort of tough guy hockey player. He very much reminds me, when he's playing well, he reminds me of Sandy McCarthy. He's just
that
mean, nasty dude.
Yeah, I can see that.
So I'm hoping Bolig's going to go down. The other question I wanted to ask you is, do you think that after what we've seen from Karri Ramo recently, do you think that he's the right guy to carry the Flames forward this year? Or do you think the Flames should still be out looking for another goaltender? Now, of course, you always say, you know, it depends on the deal that comes. If a great deal ends up in our lap, of course, we're going to take it. But if you're True Living, do you think you should be out actively pursuing and trying to make a package to bring in another goalie just simply to change up the goaltending?
The Flames need to get another Kiprusoff caliber goaltender as this rebuild continues. Whether one of the guys like Ordeo, Gillies, McDonald, or Schneider come in and become that would be great, but the Flames will need to upgrade the position regardless. Karri Ramo, he's a good stopgap goalie. Middle-of-the-road starter, having a slightly down season, more so at the beginning than recently. If the Flames can acquire somebody, that would be great, but in season, you don't usually see quality starting goaltenders getting dealt. So, unless it's at the trade deadline, then you occasionally will see some guys getting moved. Like, say, Yaroslav Halak was traded a couple of times. 2 or 3 years ago, the year before he went to the Islanders. So, we'll see. I don't see that there's an urgent need right this second to get somebody. If you can at the trade deadline, sure. But, as you said, it depends on what the deal is and who you're talking about.
I think you're right about the Flames needing that franchise goaltender. But at this point, if we look at what the Flames have available and what it would take to trade for that franchise goaltender,
doesn't make sense.
I don't see the Mika Kiprusoff sitting out there, the third string goaltender who has potential. That, I mean, remember too that we didn't trade for Kipper to be our starter. He was brought in as a backup at the time and only got the start and showed us what he could do because of the injury to Roman Turek. So, you know, I don't see that goaltender that I would want to go out and make that trade for. Now, you know, sure, we could try it, but I've heard names like Cam Ward floated around. I've heard, you know, names of other goaltenders. Anton Khudobin is on waivers right now. I don't think that we want to go out and
that's
pay.
That's just mediocrity,
well, that's
really.
It. We're replacing one mediocre goalie with another mediocre goalie.
Like, I don't even know if Anton Khudobin is even an upgrade on how Jonas Hiller has played this year. So
no, I think he would be your sort of backup for Ordeo on the farm. And, I mean, you mentioned Halak. If we look at the Halak deals that have happened, they've been fairly big deals. If we look when Washington acquired Halak, they got Halak in a third rounder for Michael Neuvirth and Klesla from Buffalo fairly big deal when St. Louis made the trade. They traded, or they got Ryan Miller and Steve Ott for Halak, Stewart, William Carrier, a first round and a third round. You know, I'm not willing to pay that kind of price right now. And then when Montreal made the trade, they got Lars Eller and Ian Schultz for Halak. So I'm not willing to pay anywhere near those kind of prices for a goalie right now. I think Hiller's good enough. And to me, if we don't get as far in the playoffs as we want to because we don't have a good goaltender this year, I'm fine with that. If we miss the playoffs because of our goaltending, I'm fine with that, as long as we're on the search for that guy. But I would hate to see us go out and acquire a Cam Ward or somebody that just to get a short-term gain. I think we're still looking at this long-term, and either through draft, trade, or, as you said, hopefully a guy in our own organization, Gillies, Schneider, Ordeo, we have to find that guy, and that needs to be priority one as the long-term goaltender.
And one good thing is that if you look at the Edmonton Oilers, you can use them once again as a tale of caution. Don't acquire backups from good teams. Cam Talbot has not been very good this year after being one of the top goalies in the NHL, but when you're playing behind the New York Rangers, it makes your life a little easier. Mm-hmm. So if the Flames do go on the hunt for a goaltender from another organization that's a backup, it also depends on which team you're talking about.
If you look at any other team, if Brad Treliving phones you up and says, hey, I want your goaltender, and you take a look at our roster and what you're going to want back, I mean, you know, you're not going to say, yeah, I'll give you, let's just say, a backup I would acquire if it was me. And I think Antti Niemi is a decent goalie. Antti Rant is a good goalie, both of them. I could see both teams parting with them. But let's say Rant out of New York. You're not going to say, you know what, I'll give you my backup and you give me Josh Juris and Bolig and Raymond and we got a deal. I mean, these guys are going to be looking for, you know, a Frolik.
Say like Poirier or Klimchuk.
Yeah, Poirier. Or even if they want to help themselves in the playoffs, you know, a David Jones and a pick or something like that. And I don't want to...
Kris Russell or, yeah, something good, not just a third round pick.
Yeah, which I think the only way we could do that, and again, we'd have to find some GM who's solely looking at this year, would be at the deadline, you bring in a young goaltender for, say, the Dennis Weidman contract, or you bring in a young goaltender for Yari Hudler as a rental. But you'd have to have a team that's so focused on winning this year, they'd be willing to give up one of their, you know, goalie prospects. And looking around the league, I don't see that team yet.
Yeah, like if you were... Say, like, you're talking the Anaheim Ducks just for simplicity because they do have two quality netminders. If they were in the playoff picture and the Flames aren't, it might be a situation where you could flip Hudler plus something for Anderson or Gibson, depending on which. Not necessarily that situation, but you know what I mean. Like, where you got two decent young goaltenders and you might be able to snag one of them.
Yeah, but no, I don't want to see the team get caught up in playoff frenzy and go out and pay a lot for a goalie who's going to be a stopgap, who's going to be here for a year or two. I think both of our goaltenders have contracts that expire at the end of the year. Hiller and Rama are both out of here. I don't think it'd be prudent to re-sign either one of them now. I would let them both walk away and reassess in the summer if it's time to bring in another, you know, maybe one of them comes back, almost a backup to Ordeo or Gillies or somebody like that as the veteran guy. But I think that what we have in Ramo is suitable enough for this year. And if you look at what Ramo's done for the Flames so far, you know, yes, there's things he needs to correct to keep the Flames in the playoff hunt. He needs to make early saves. He needs to make sure the Flames don't get into a hole early. He needs better rebound control. There's a lot of things he's not doing right. He's not a number one goaltender for a second, third round playoff team. But I think for where we are, we ride him out for the rest of the year.
And carrying on with that point, the guy that I personally would target out of the entire NHL would actually be Kristaps Gudalevskis, the third string goaltender for Tampa. They have both Bishop and Vasilevsky. And Gudelevsky's has actually been playing rather well in both his short stints in the NHL and in the AHL. So it's one of those situations that if you could, that would be a decent target.
Yeah. I mean, if you just want to move just to get a goaltender, talk to Toronto. You know.
True. Yeah, you could probably pick up Bernier for nothing or Reimer for
nothing.
Well,
that's it. If the Flames decide they just want to make a goalie trade, I bet we could get Bernier or Reimer for one of our goalies back and, you know.
And like a fifth or something
fifth
like that.
Or, you know, move Juris.
A marginal prospect.
Yeah, Juris or a marginal prospect. Like, I bet Toronto would make a move just to get a different goalie in their system. And I mean, if you look at, you know, Bernier, he's making about the same as Hiller is. You know, Reimer's cheap and he's on a 1 year. So if you just want to change goalies, talk to Toronto. But if you're looking for the long term goalie, I don't think neither Bernier nor Reimer is your long term guy.
No. That's why I mentioned Gudelevsky's, because he's only 23. So he would fit in that realm, but it would have to be a significant trade. I don't think you'd get him for less than a second plus.
No.
It would have to be like a Weidman or a Hudler style trade.
But, you know, I wouldn't be opposed to Reimer perhaps coming in free agency as the backup here. I think Reimer's a decent NHL goaltender. I wouldn't want to ride him for 70 games, but I'd be okay riding him for 20 games.
Or 30 or 40.
Yeah, if we've got someone who we believe in, if they say finally, okay, Ordeo's finally our guy. Last year we were just kidding, but this year he's really our guy. You know, Reimer would be a decent guy there. But to me, if you just want to make a change, talk to Toronto, because you're going to get a new goalie for as cheap as possible. I bet we could trade, say, Hiller and a fifth, like you said, for one of their goalies.
Mm-hmm.
No problem. And we could probably get it done in an afternoon. But I don't think it's time to make a big deal for a goalie this year.
No. And the situation, it depends on how literally the next 2 months go. If the Flames are in a playoff spot, then sure, you look at trying to find that upgrade where possible. If they're completely out of it, well, there's not really any urgency. If the Flames regress back to being in the basement, I don't think the goaltending matters one way or the other.
No, it doesn't. I don't know. It's going to be interesting to see what happens with the Flames. We've seen this sort of progression over the last couple of years where the Flames seem to be focused on forwards, and they went out and drafted a bunch of forwards and developed a bunch of forwards. And this past offseason, it seemed like defensemen were our target. We brought in Hamilton, we brought in Shillington, we brought in Anderson, we brought in, you know, Nakladal, we brought in Morrison. So it's like, okay, we've got the defensemen in the system. You wonder if this is going to be the summer of goaltenders.
Very well could be.
They seem to kind of be going forward defense. It's the next logical thing. If you look at our cupboards, where we have the most weakness is probably goaltending, and maybe that's the next focus. Maybe over their rebuild, it's, you know, let's spend a summer focusing on each one.
And realistically, the Flames needed, just in terms of raw numbers, there are more forwards than there are defensemen than there are goaltenders. So the Flames needed to flesh out the farm system with forwards. When it was back in 2010, the Flames farm system didn't have anything, really. So they needed to stock those things. Now they've been lacking on defense. Now they're starting to address that, getting Hickey in there as well. So now that's starting to become an organizational strength. And as you said, now it's time to find the goalie. I'm always of the opinion that until you get your, like, Jonathan Quick, Tuukka Rask, that upper tier guy, you add one goalie to your organization every year through the draft until you find that guy. It might not be Gillies, it might not be Ordeo, it might not be McDonald or Schneider, it might be the guy that they draft this year, but you have to keep cycling those guys in until you find that guy.
I agree with you, but I don't think that guy necessarily always has to be added through draft.
No.
I think it could be through trade, through UFA, but you got to be trying a new goaltender in your system somewhere every year.
And eventually you'll find that good goaltender, just like the Flames found Mika Kiprusoff. You just have to keep doing it until you do find that player.
And to their credit in that point, I mean, they signed Ramo to a one-year deal. You know, that tells us this is not the guy of the future, and even the Flames know that. This guy's good enough for now.
Mm-hmm. And you look at Hiller, he's okay, playing well enough where he's an NHL goalie. That's fine. When they signed him to the mm-hmm. two-year deal, he wasn't the goalie that you're going to be carrying for 5 years.
No, and he's 33, he's making 4.5. He had a proven NHL record, and it's like, okay, looking around the organization, he's the right guy for now. But the Flames are not touting either of these guys the goalie of the future. I'm not sure what's going to end up with Ordeo. I mean, I like Ordeo. I think he's shown some good things in the past. I'm not sure where he sits with the organization anymore, but, you know, maybe.
No, and even in Stockton, he hasn't been playing particularly well. He's had a couple of games where he's really good, other games where he's really bad. And
see, to me, I think we got to give him some time because he always takes a while to get started, and he's really just starting his season now.
True. And if he can figure it out in Stockton, maybe he's your deadline acquisition, and you bring him up towards the end of the season to be the starter. Who knows? But we just have to wait and see.
Yeah.
And there's just not enough information wholly on the entire goalie organization that we have to be able to definitively say, okay, this is the direction that we need to go. And that will shake out as the season progresses.
I think for right now, to me, Ramo has earned the right to keep starting.
Yep, I agree.
You know, he's the best thing we got. I don't want to move any other pieces, as we talked about, to get a new goalie. I don't think it's mission critical at this point. So to me, for better or for worse, we have to run with Ramo until probably the deadline and see, you know, how things go there. But I wouldn't be in an immediate position to change him.
No.
Well, Matt, I think that's pretty much most of the Flames news for this week. Any other big topics you want to talk about?
Not particularly. It's just been nice to see the Flames collecting win after win after win.
Coming into the second show in a row with a smile on my face, which is different for this year.
Yeah.
We have a bit of a programming note for everybody with the holiday season coming. Usually we record on Mondays. Next weekend we will not be recording Monday. We'll be recording on Wednesday the 23rd of next week. So that puts 5 games before we record next. That means that our next show probably won't come out until the weekend after Christmas, the 27th, 28th, somewhere in that area. So you guys are going to have a little bit more time before you hear us next. And we're going to be taking a bit of a holiday break during that time, and we'll probably come back on the 4th of January, early in the new year. So it gives us a bit of a break. It gives you guys some chance to spend time with your family and not be listening to us. And, just wanted to let everyone know that we're going to be late next week. So if you don't see things in your feed on Wednesdays, don't panic. Look for it maybe Saturday, but I'd probably say Sunday or the following Monday would be your best bet. We're also asking people to give us listener feedback, as we have in the past. If you go to firesidechat.ca, you can go there, and on the right-hand side of the page, you'll see a button to leave us a voicemail. Or if you want to join the conversation, you can click on or roll your mouse over the podcast link at the top navigation and click join the conversation in the menu that comes out. Leave us a voicemail, send us an email, tweet to us, talk to us on Facebook, whatever you want to do. But we want your predictions for 2016. Do you think the Flames are going to keep up the run they've got now? Do you think they can parlay this into a playoff spot this year? Or do you think what we're seeing is a flash in the pan, it's a win streak, and the Flames are going to end up at the bottom of the league in the top 5 draft picks or something in between? So give us your feedback, and Matt and I will discuss this in the new year with hopefully some of your feedback thrown in there.
Yeah, we look forward to hearing from you, and we'd like to have more fan interaction on this show. So we're more than willing to put your voices into the show and discuss what you want to talk about.
If you've got something intelligent to say, we want to talk to you. If you don't, call Steinberg on overtime. But we want, you know, we want you guys to give us your feedback. And Matt and I, you hear us talk all the time. You know our opinions. You probably know roughly what our opinion is going to be of this team in the new year. But let's hear you guys and let's see what you want. Matt, I guess with that, it's probably time for our ending segment, our weekly predictions. We have a new sponsor that's joined us on Fireside Chat. The segment now, the weekly predictions, are going to be sponsored from here on in. And we have a new sponsor. Their name is TickTix. I don't know how many people have heard of them. They're a mobile ticket exchange. It's interesting because Matt is a season ticket holder, so he's always trying to sell tickets to games he doesn't want to go to. I don't have season tickets, and I try to go to as many games as I can afford, and I'm trying to buy tickets. So, Matt, I imagine as a season ticket holder, you've got hassles. As a buyer, I've got hassles. What are some of the things that are pain in the butt for you?
Well, anytime that your plans change last minute, it's always a scramble to try and find somebody to buy your tickets. And having TickTix available, I haven't used them yet, but I've heard a lot of good things about how easy and user-friendly it is. So I'm sure that the next time I do end up selling my tickets, I will be using their services.
I hate it when I'm buying tickets and it's last minute or not, and someone wants to meet me somewhere. I don't want to meet you in some, you know, dark alley to get your tickets. I'm always hesitant to buy tickets digitally because I don't know if it's legitimate or if they've sold that same ticket to, you know, 12 different guys. So I'm not really sure when I buy tickets who I'm buying from. And there's always the, you know, the inflated cost of fees, and you're not sure if you're buying from someone who actually owns those tickets. You're not sure if you're buying from a guy who's reselling resold tickets. TickTix changes all that. TickTix is actually run here out of Calgary by Flames fans. These were season ticket holders looking for a better way to sell tickets. TickTix connects the Sea of Red to buy and sell tickets securely from their phones. It's the first mobile-only, mobile-focused ticket platform. TickTix lets sellers sell for free and verifies the sellers so buyers don't get ripped off. Tickets are delivered digitally, so there's no hassle in trying to pick up your tickets, trying to meet somebody somewhere, that sort of thing. You can download TickTix in the Google Play Store or the iOS App Store. So if you're an Android or iOS user, it's there for you. Get your tickets now and enjoy the great run the Flames are on. Buy some tickets for that week after Christmas when the Flames come back and enjoy these games that the Flames are playing. So thanks, TickTix, for joining us on Fireside Chat and for sponsoring our weekly predictions. Looking back at last week, Matt, we had 6 points available. I said that we'd probably get 4 points. I thought we'd beat the Sharks and Buffalo, and you thought we'd get 2 and just beat Buffalo. And if you look, we have not had somebody right in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 weeks. We've either been too pessimistic or too optimistic.
Yeah.
So this coming week, we've got 5 games on the table, 10 total points. What do you think we're going to do, Matt?
Well, it's a very tough stretch for the Flames. They play Nashville, Dallas, St. Louis, Detroit, and Winnipeg. The only easier game from that lot is the Jets, and even they're pretty good. It'll be a make-or-break stretch, and if the Flames are serious about becoming a contending team, for the 4-game road trip, I think they need to get at least 4 points.
You got to do at least 500.
And I think that they'll beat the Jets, so I'm going to hope for 6, but I'm going to say 4 out of the 5 games.
So which games do you think they're going to win?
I think they'll beat Nashville and Winnipeg.
So you're going to go with 4 of the 10 points you think they'll get.
Yes.
So not...
I'm hopeful that they can beat Detroit as well. I think that Dallas is going to be ticked off after how they got embarrassed the last time they played us. So I think that they'll manhandle the Flames. And Calgary always struggles against St. Louis. So we'll see.
Yeah, I agree with you about Dallas. I don't think Dallas is going to let us out of their building easy after the last game. We always struggle against St. Louis. I'm going to go with 5 points this week. I think that we're going to beat Nashville. I think going in with the momentum the Flames have, they're going to beat Nashville. I think they'll probably lose to Dallas and lose to St. Louis. I think they're going to beat Winnipeg, and I think they're going to make it out of Detroit with 1 point. So I'm going pretty much same as you, but I think we'll get 1 point against Detroit.
Well, at least we're both being pessimistic, so hopefully the Flames do the inverse of what we said and get like 8 points or nine.
Can you imagine, though, if we end up getting all, let's say that we get all 10 of them, like going on a 10-game win streak this month, that's going to really propel us up the standings. It's not going to be enough to, you know, get us into a third spot in the Pacific and keep us there. But that's really going to help.
Oh no! If we win all five in a row, I think the Flames will have second in the Pacific.
They'll have second, but I don't think it's necessarily going to be enough to keep us there. We're going to have to keep fighting to keep that.
Oh no! This five-game winning streak, all it's done is erased the really pathetically poor first 2 months of the season, and now we're pretty much back to even. Now we have. We've started over, now it's a sprint from here for the next 50 games to the finish.
Mm-hmm. You know, it'll be interesting to see, because if you look at the team, we now know they can win, right? I mean, we know this team can win. We've seen them do it. So it shouldn't really matter what building or what color you're wearing. Guys, you've won five in a row, just keep doing it.
Well, that's the next test. Like, the Flames have shown that they can win on home ice. They've won 9 in a row in the Saddle Dome. Of the 13 games they've played on the road, though, they've only won 3 times. And that's the next challenge. And with having a 4-game road trip against the elite teams, that doesn't get any easier. So they will have to show that. Not only can they win in Calgary, they need to show that they can win in the opposition's building. And until that sorts itself out, I don't consider the Flames a serious contender for a playoff spot.
No.
They have to show that they can win wherever
they
are.
Yeah, you've got to win at home on the road. It doesn't matter if you're wearing red or white. You've just got to win hockey games if you're going to be a serious playoff team. On the flip side, though, if the Flames can get through this road trip, things get a lot easier for them. Matt, you were doing some analysis of the schedule. Do you want to share what you found?
Yeah, the next 4 games are going to be extremely tough for the Flames. All 4 of the teams are in the top 10 in the standings. They're all elite teams. However, after that, the next 22 games that extend all the way into the middle of February, only 4 of those 22 games are against teams that are even in the top 15. 18 of those are against teams that are in the basement. And I think only 1 or 2 of the other 18 games are against teams that are in the 16 to 20 spots. So we're pretty much playing all weaker teams. I don't think there's any truly bad teams in the NHL this year, but weaker teams. So if the Flames can weather the storm on the 4-game road trip, they do stand a good chance to go on a very protracted run, especially if they continue to keep up with playing a very solid effort each game.
I think even if they don't win the games in the road trip, if we can see that they're, you know, improving their game, if we can see some positive movement we've talked about all year, you know, if they can get up and not, you know, lose a game that they've got in the bag 4-1 and end up, you know, losing that or having to go to overtime, that's positive. We can see the special teams getting better, that's going to be positive. So I think these 4 games, as much as we want to win them, they're really important to set the pace going forward. Because if we can beat these 4 teams, or most of these, I think you're right, with the schedule we have coming up, we're going to prove that we can play, maybe not keep up with all of them, but we can play with the big boys in the league this year.
Yeah, and realistically, with the 5 games, if you include the Rangers one, because they are a top 10 team, that's a really tough stretch. And as long as you're holding your own, getting 4 or 5 points out of that stretch, that's okay.
It's crazy to think we're going to have a 10-game win streak this month.
And if you look at even like an elite team, say Dallas, if they're facing five of the other top 10 teams, they're going to struggle as well. It's not like they're going to just mop the floor with them because, oh, we're Dallas. So if the Flames can just hold their own over this next stretch of games, that will set themselves up very well moving beyond that.
To me, this week is really about the Flames showing us what they're made of. They're on the road where they've struggled. Mind you, they've struggled at home too, but they're coming around there. This is really where we see what this team's got. Was this a flash in the pan, or has this team actually turned things around? And I think this is really going to show us who the Calgary Flames are this year. If we can make it out of these games with a respectable record and a respectable effort in each one, I'm going to be a lot more positive after Christmas that Santa might be able to deliver us a playoff spot.
And that would be a pleasant surprise for every Flames fan.
But I think if anyone's expecting this road trip to be a 10-game win streak, you're crazy.
It would be nice, but
we're lucky to have the five we have. I mean, the Flames should not have won all five of those. If you look back at them, as we talked about,
we were lucky.
We got lucky, and the hockey gods can only help us so much before we've got to, you know, put up or shut up.
We'll see. Fun times ahead.
Well, Matt, thanks a lot, and we will talk to you just the day before Christmas next weekend for our later show in the week.
Yeah, on the 23rd.
23rd.
So Christmas Eve Eve.
Is that a thing?
I don't know.
Eve before Christmas Eve? We need.
Who knows?
We need to get like an advent calendar with the Flames games so we can count down how many days till Christmas based on how many games there are.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we'll talk to you then, and everyone else won't hear us before Christmas. They'll hear us after. So for everyone, no matter what you celebrate, Christmas, Hanukkah, something else, I hope everybody has a great holiday season with their family and friends. You have a great rest and enjoy a lot of Flames hockey because there's still a lot of good hockey to enjoy this month.
Merry Christmas, everybody, and stay safe and have a responsible, healthy holiday season.
Don't drink and drive. Be back here to listen to us again after Christmas, but enjoy the time with your family and friends. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under a Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.